it covers me. It covers me. Grace flows down and covers me.
Jesus. Thank the Lord for waking us up this morning and starting us on our way. Thank the Lord for blessing us to see this new day, for this is the day the Lord has made. And I now look at it in terms of times and seasons. You can endeavor to rejoice and be glad in it. And nevertheless, being a time and a season of weeping or mourning. And so God allowed us to have these feelings and emotions. And the shortest scripture simply says, "In Jesus wept," not "In Jesus rejoiced," you know, "In Jesus wept." And so you allowed to have these feelings and emotions and to respond to life. And to respond to, you know, your season, as you now respond with jackets and coats, and some people already hats, and maybe even gloves, I don't know. But you're responding to the, you know, to the time and season. And you're supposed to. And so therefore, for those who right now rejoice and glad in it, you know, thank God for you. For those who must weep and mourn, you know, thank God for you. Giving respect to all and having an understanding of all, you see. And so we thank the Lord for those that are happy. You know, happy is based on happenings, those that are happy. We thank God for those that he's walking with that are sad. We thank God for those he's walking with that are rejoicing. And we thank God for those that are mourning. And we thank God for walking with them. And, you know, it's one thing to go through. It's another thing to go through with in the Lord's hand. It's one thing to go through. It's another thing to go through and see only one set of footprints in the sand. As the writer wrote, it is then that I realized, you know, that he was carrying me. You know, thank God that you could be 3 times 7 and then some, and yet God still be able to carry you. For that, I would always be eternally grateful and mindful of him. You know, we're constantly keeping in mind of this time and season, and you're not afraid, you're not scared, but you are watching as well as praying. You've been instructed to watch as well as pray. You have a mandate and an assignment to watch as well as pray. And to, you know, consider the time and the season. If you have your Bible, turn me to Genesis, the first chapter. Genesis 1. And we ask God for his help, and we thank God for prayer, praise, and worship. You know, for a resemblance of church, and, you know, thank God for it, and thank God for the prayer team and the ministers, lay members alike. You know, that for those that are able to encourage one another in the Lord, you know, for this is good and this is right. And to not take anything for granted. In Genesis, that now that our triune is, you know, is in different places, and our spirit know things our mind has not comprehended. My mind hasn't comprehended the word, the message. But I trust Jesus. You know, it's what I do. Don't you see? It's what I do. Genesis 1, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. In the Genesis, in the beginning, in the incipient stages of all that we see and all that we know, and then things that we don't know. There's many things about earth we don't know. But in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Interesting, he don't put an S on either one, the heavens and the earths. But he created the heaven and the earth. And the earth that God created, that's so interesting, was without form that God created, and void. And darkness was upon the face of the deep. And again, my mind says, in what God created. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw that light, that it was good. And God divided light from the darkness. And God divided light from the darkness. And we're going to stay right there for a few minutes. And we trust Jesus by faith to walk it out for us. Because this is, as I stated before, a never before seen time for me. That everything is unusual, and everything is different, and everything is forcing change, and everything is not normal. I don't have a problem with it either. I really don't. Because Spirit was already crying out for change, but I always say to people, you never know how that change is coming. So you have to trust God when you say certain prayers, because you don't know how it's coming. When you ask God to save someone, or ask God to deliver, or ask God to keep, or you never know how God would choose to do exactly what you ask him. No, when you ask God, for those that are bold enough, you know, and not just bold enough, but it really love is everything, you know. And for those who love the Lord and they're also bold enough to ask God to take them higher, you know. Now the older saints used to pray, take me higher. Well, you never know how he's going to take you higher. And when I was ministered 2 years ago that God was going to do a quick work in me, sound good, you know, coming out of pastor's mouth and sound good, you know. But I did not know that for me, that quick work meant test after test, trial after trial. I didn't know that the floor would disappear right beneath my feet and that life would change right before my eyes. I did not know that. I did not know this quick work was also a place that I could also falter in and quit or turn coward in spiritually or throw my hands up and, you know, and say, you know, I just don't get this. As the enemy stood in a corner waiting for a time to be himself, which is the accuser of the brethren, to say before God how I was not qualified or deserving of whatever God wanted to do in me. Remember, many are called, but few chosen. It depends on how you handle the call and how you handle that place of preparation, that place of preparation to be chosen. You know, wherever God is going to take you, there's a place of preparation for it first. And they don't scratch his head and wonder what to do with me and wonder what to do with you. He know what to do with me. He know what to do with you. And that place of preparation, it reveals you and it exposes you and it shows you. You see? To both God and the devil. And to yourself. In threes, you know? And so, change. Not something I fear, you know, because we cried out for it. And it's just such an unusual time that you had to really, you know, God doesn't show any man everything, but you at least wanted to look through that glass dimly or darkly and see something that said change is coming. And, you know, and thank God for nothing to just throwing us off our square, as they say. You know, but even just as far as 12 years ago, you wouldn't have, if someone would have told you 12 years ago, you know, before Barack Obama took office, 12 years ago, that with all these churches in Chicago and all of these so-called super saints in Chicago and with all these politicians soliciting Christian votes from Christian platforms, you know, and at the Christian altars and in the Christian pulpits, you wouldn't have believed 12 years ago that Chicago would have a lesbian mayor married to a woman. You wouldn't believe that. And that she would be a woman of color. You would not have believed that 12 years ago that a black woman of color would be mayor and a lesbian married to a white woman. You wouldn't have believed that 12 years ago. You wouldn't have believed 12 years ago that Illinois would have a governor who was investigated by the federal investigators for tax fraud and still, you know, be voted in governor. You wouldn't have believed that 12 years ago. 12 years ago, you wouldn't have believed that a man could plagiarize his whole life and be accused of sexual harassment and lie about how many degrees he has. He has one and said he had three and lie about finishing in the top of his class in law school and be found to have been finished in the bottom of his class. You wouldn't have believed 12 years ago, you know, that a man who could spearhead a bill incarcerating a mass amount of people of color would be president. You wouldn't have believed that 12 years ago, who his own peers said years ago his political career was ruined. You wouldn't have believed that 12 years ago that you would see same-sex marriage in every state and you would see pro-choicers, you know, dominating pro-life. And you wouldn't believe that 12 years ago that, you know, that someone pushed by the LGBTQ and pushed by the pro-choice and pushed by a witchcraft movement that they call Black Lives Matter would be president. You wouldn't believe that 12 years ago. You wouldn't believe that those same people believe that church folk are not relevant and are non-essential. You wouldn't have believed that 12 years ago. That's how fast things can change. And things can change with a phone call, with a diagnosis, with a knock on the door. You know, the sudden change. They say that the deepest grief one can suffer is the unexpected grief. You know, the unexpected phone call, the unexpected knock on the door, the unexpected diagnosis, you know, that the deep runs the deepest, the grief runs the deepest. And then to be in a day where life and darkness, anytime you could turn on your television and watch programs called Snapped, Secrets Uncovered, Up and Vanished, Murder by Morning, In Ice Cold Blood, Killer Couples, Killer Siblings, Killer Twins, Criminal Confessions, The DNA of Murder, Killer Motive, Killer Affairs, Snap Secret Affairs, Chaos in Court, Crimes Gone Viral, Real Life Nightmare, Very Scary People, Buried in the Backyard, Injustice with Nancy Grace, Twisted Sisters, Evil Lives Here, Disappeared, For My Man, Evil Twins, American Monster, Signs of a Psychopath, Diabolical, Betrayed, Killer Couples, Web of Lies, Suspicion, Fatal Attraction, First 48, See No Evil, Deadly Cults, and the list goes on and on of programs. Now, each one that can have one in 200, you know, episodes and 300 episodes that speak volume to the nature of the American people. At any time, you can just look and say and see how abased and how low a so-called Christian nation, but we know it's backslidden, have fallen. And it's, and now remember, for those who have said in our Bible studies, before the 9/11 attack on America, Osama bin Laden, giving his only interview to an American journalist, stated that we have witnessed the decay within the American government within the last decade. So we have witnessed the decay of the morality within the American government within the last decade. And that was then. That we have witnessed. Who is we? Well, the enemies of America have watched and witnessed at that time the decay of morality, of how we live. He said, we didn't watch everyone. We just watched the head. He said, because they say if the head is sick, the whole body's sick. And we just watched the head, the American government. And we watched the decay in their morality. Well, what you think they think now when they look at American television and see people have voted by way of mail, and when they search some of their names, they are deceased. They have people who are dead who votes were counted. What do you think they see when they see violence in the street and a man who did nothing to deserve being choked out by those in authority with his knee on his neck? What do you think they think about the protection and the security of the American people when they witness the foolery in the debates and the foolery, you know, that's being broadcast worldwide, when they see the violence in cities like Chicago and the surrounding suburbs alike? What do you think they think, you know, when they about our morality and how well we can defend this nation? What do you think they think? If it is, I don't even know if it's 4 times, 5 times, 6 times worse than it was when 9/11 took place. We just know that it's very much worse. What do you think they think when America can't humble herself enough to protect herself, and then to see all these underlying health issues and COVID reach numbers that on paper, from what they say, no other nation can reach or country can reach? What do you think they think? Because these are not programs that are being ushered in from around the world. These are American programs we're talking about that are showing the heart of the American people. What do you think they think? How well are we protected? How well, when they said they saw the decay in the morality of the American government, what they were saying was, what bin Laden was saying was, I see a nation who have turned away from their God. This is what I see. And we see a nation that if God was on their side, surely this is the time to attack them, because surely he won't be on their side with this kind of disrespect toward him, toward their God. The only time God would turn his back on his people, so to say, is after his people turn their back on him. That's why it's so important that the remnant, the born again believer, it doesn't see. Isn't it amazing that heaven hasn't enlarged herself, but hell has? The Bible stressed to you that hell has enlarged herself, not heaven, hell. The Bible teaches you that there should be a massive falling away, not a massive falling in. Isn't that interesting? That God wants us to know that Christ is our personal savior, and that hell has enlarged herself for people who will turn their back on Christ, and that there shall be a mass falling away of people who will turn their back on the truth. Not a mass falling in, not a heaven enlarging herself. Isn't that interesting that history don't speak of America being a world power in the end? Isn't that interesting? As we just, I don't know, yawn and walk through life as if we don't have an appointment with death and an appointment with the Christ. Bible says that in the beginning, God created heaven and earth. And when he did, it was found to be interesting. Earth was found to be void or without form. That's so interesting that something God can create can be looked at in scripture without form. which means that special or characteristic form or feature of a person or thing that earth lacked God's characteristic, that earth lacked God's form and feature, that what God created also lacked God. Now remember, after God formed man from the dust, man was still without form. After God created man from dust, he was really still without form or without godly characteristics until God blew into his nostrils the breath of life. So an earth without God is an incomplete design. It was without form, made it void. It made it empty. It made it of no effect. Void in the Hebrew means to be empty. It means to make of no effect. Earth had no effect. And we are likened to an earth without form and void until we are inhabited by the Holy Spirit of God. People are walking around every day able, you know, to do wonderful things, yet not able to say yes and mean it, and say no and mean it, and keep a vow. Something is missing. Something has made the American people void. Of no effect. Something is missing. And God, after he created the heaven and earth, and saw that earth was without form and void, and darkness, where there is no light, there will be darkness. Where there is no light, there will be darkness. Now, light is defined as life. Light is defined as life itself. For John 1 and 4 says, in him, John 1 and 4, in him was life. And the life was the light of men. In him was life. And the life was the light of men. Now, John the Baptist was a light, but he was not that light. It was not Christ's light. No. But this life is a gift Jesus brought from God into a dying world. And the life was the light of men. So where there is darkness, that means it's void of light. When a soul is dark, or like they want to try to make a people of color feel like they are cursed people or people of darkness, what they're trying to say is you lack light. And where there's no light, darkness will reign. Now, the only way to receive life, eternal life, is to be known of the light through God and his promises. You cannot sugarcoat that as you deal with the mirror. You cannot sugarcoat that as you deal with family and friends and loved ones. You cannot sugarcoat that as you deal with coworkers. The only way to receive eternal life is to be known, intimate and known of the light through God and God's promises. Light is the spiritual and the divine. It's the illumination and the intelligence. It is the source of goodness and the ultimate reality, light. Christ's light gives us life and keep darkness at bay and away from us. You can literally, I told my daughter, I said, we have crossed paths and walked right past psychopaths and fools and rapists and thieves and murderers. Mentally ill, violent. We have walked right past them. But the light of God forced that darkness to keep walking. The light of God forced that darkness to keep right walk, keep on walk right past us. When you can leave home and get back home safe and sound, in this day, you ought to thank God as you put the key in the door. You ought to be thanking God for taking you and bringing you. Because anything can happen today. Anything. I think, one of the things is you have a responsibility. I thank God every day that I'm alive and every day that I'm not sick and every day that, and I think I might have contracted the COVID virus simply because I'm supposed to. And it's not that I'm super saint or junior Jesus. The grace of God, for whatever reasons, and the mercies of God, I have not had it. And I just thank him every day that I haven't, and thank him every day that he is keeping me. And you must stop as light and acknowledge the light and thank him every day, because Christ's light is what's keeping darkness away. That's why you'll see people who walk in the light. Now, let me say something to you. I've seen multiple preachers, multiple Christians be promoted by God, then handle the promotion terribly and allow darkness to seep in. The more God do for you, the more humility should rest upon you. The more he gives you, the more he blesses you, the more he does for you, the more humble you should become. Not boisterous, not proud, not full of pride, not with a grandiose mentality. It should humble you. I've seen multiple people get promotions in the spirit and then allow darkness to come in through the pride of heart, and not be able to maintain that promotion. God doesn't promote you to get somewhere and then make you an adulterer and a fornicator. God don't promote you, and then the promotion is what leads you back to a perverted lifestyle. God don't promote you and then lead you to embarrass him and hurt your family and hurt your name. That light is supposed to burn even brighter. And as long as that light is burning, it pushes darkness away. Every one of us has a certain amount of darkness that's trying to get in our light. But it's the light. As long as the light is on, darkness cannot reign. Now, Christ's light will never leave me. Christ's light won't leave you. But I want you to know that neither will darkness. As long as we are a product of time, you will always have to deal with light and darkness, good and evil. Light always involves the removal of darkness. But darkness will always be here because darkness is a product of sin. David said, in iniquity and sin was I conceived, and I did the things I was supposed to do, being conceived the way I was. So have mercy on me, O Lord, according to thy loving kindness, according to thy tender mercies. God created light and spoken into being for a purpose. Light is here to dominate and to keep darkness at bay. And when you see all of this darkness is a sign of a non-essential, a non-relevant church. I don't care how they stand in the street and cry that we essential, that we somebody. What darkness is saying that we're not. Too much darkness for you to say the light is on. Too much darkness in our personal life for us to say the light is on. Too much darkness going on in our personal life for us to say we full of light. Too much darkness going on the block for us to say we the light of the block. Too much darkness going on in the community for us to say we the light of the community. You know how many churches in Illinois? You know how many churches in Chicago? You know how many churches in the surrounding suburbs? So why all the darkness? Every time you turn around, another church person, another leader, another lay member, another person that says they're a Christian, falling in the face of the people. One of the reasons why you will see people not respect people who they know is because they see a lot of darkness. So you can respect a person and think highly of them, but you can meet their family and their family don't feel that way. Why? If you super whatever, why don't your family see it? Well, you know your house is the last one to notice you got something. Well, you know a prophet is honored everywhere but in his home. Let me say something to you. When people who know you personally know you got something with God, you really have something with God. And there's too many people who will speak to the darkness in people versus the light for them to really have a burning light. Light is everything God, where darkness evokes everything that is anti-God. And God looked at something he created and said, but it's not right until I fill it with light. Over in Proverbs, the second chapter, the 12 through the 14th verse, it teaches us that an evil man leave the path of the uprightness to walk in the ways of darkness and rejoice in doing evil. These people will run, they have all kinds of games where the game is to run past and I'm going to hit this person who just walking, minding his own business. And the game is, can I knock him out with one punch? And then if they can knock him out with one punch and put him on Facebook or whatever they do, YouTube, and then laugh about it. They laugh about it. They laugh when they can take someone's daughter and have a threesome with her and defile her and they tape it. You know, fools have been caught by the police for simply taping and posting things and laughing about it. Well, the Bible said that the evil, those that lack light, will rejoice in doing evil. Laugh about it. John 1 and 5 says, and the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. What do you mean light? What do you mean darkness and light? What do you mean the darkness comprehended it not? That the darkness couldn't comprehend light? Could understand it and understand its purpose was to shine bright. When you've been under all this message and all this word and all these prophecies and all this praise and worship and not comprehend it, not know your worth and value, that there's someone who's been sitting in church, that no matter what they've heard, they're gonna take their first drink. They're gonna smoke their first smoke. They're gonna snort their first cocaine. They're gonna do their first fornication. They're gonna commit their first adultery, sitting right in the light and not comprehending it. Some things I learned not by what I went through, but by what you went through, by what other people went through. When I was making a bunch of mistakes in my life, my spiritual father called me once and said, Al, I'm learning what not to do by watching you. Not learning what to do, I'm learning what not to do by watching you. Interesting. That light can shine and darkness comprehend it not. John 3:19 says, and this is the condemnation. When you hear condemnation here, it means this is the verdict. The verdict is in. The verdict is in. This is the verdict. This is the condemnation. That light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light. Why? The Bible said, because their deeds were evil. Do you know that people love leadership that fail because it makes them look better and it helps them to understand? When a preacher fall and a first lady fall and a minister fall, the first thing people say is, see, these people just like everybody else. They just like everybody else. They're people like everybody else. Putting these people on a pedestal, they ain't nobody but people like everybody else. And we all make mistakes. Because they feel better that they don't have to look up, that they can look eye to eye or look down. They feel better that they can come in that person's presence and not feel condemnation, not feel conviction. See, when you live right, when people come around you, there's a level of conviction that oozes off of you and off of them, you know. Like a cheating man who come into a sanctified wife, it's like putting coals of hot fire upon his head. Just looking at her. Just looking at her. And the Bible said, this is the verdict. The light is come. Not coming, it is come. Into the world, and men love darkness rather than light. Why? Because it makes me feel better, because my deeds are evil. See, when I first got into the counseling and dealing with couples, I thought when people cheated and hurt each other, that the person who was cheated on would develop the hardness of heart. If they were not careful, Moses gave you a writing of divorce, but from the beginning, this was not so, said Christ Jesus. But I say, save fornication because of the hardness of your heart. And I always thought that meant that I can get hurt so bad that my heart get hard and that I need to get out of this relationship. Because it won't soften in this relationship. It'll only get harder. And hardness of heart because of adultery, fornication, God allows you out of that relationship. But then I start meeting people who the person getting cheated on and cursed out and lied to is saying, I just want my marriage to work. And I just want us to put this behind us and our marriage work. And the person who committing the fornication, who doing all the cursing and lying, hating this person more and more because they make them feel bad just being in their presence. And they wish that God, this saint, would curse them out and cheat on them and do to them what they're doing to them so they can feel better. And I was shocked when I started seeing the enemy with hardness of heart. The liar. Getting more and more hard of heart as a person standing their conviction. Walking their light. See, the devil trying to give the world a light. Because, you know, he want to be like or ass. But they don't have a real light. You don't know it until you put God's light next to their light. Then you will see that they don't have a real light. A worldly man can't touch me. Now, a carnal or natural woman may think he can, but a worldly man can't touch me. A worldly man or woman can't touch you. Their light can't match yours. Only someone blind would choose something other than that. Only someone blind and evil would choose something other than a real light. But what happens when there's no real light burning? Then you give the world no choice but to choose darkness. Because where there is no light, darkness will dominate. But what's the problem then? Well, Matthew 5 says, Matthew 5:13 says, ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost its savior, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing. Oh my God. It is now good for nothing. Without the light, without the life and the life, we good for nothing. We non-essential. Go home. You ain't got no light, so go home, church. You're making it worse. And they sent us home. And I'll never forget and not take it personal, we were sent home. They were saying that we were good for nothing. But and the scripture said, but to be cast out and to be trodden under the foot of men. They don't want our advice. They don't want our counsel. They don't care who we want in office. They don't care what. Heard a group of preachers say, who was a group of Caucasian pastors say, who was voting for Trump, say, we've never said he was a strong Christian, but we're voting for him because he kept every Christian promise he made to the Christian community. He kept the promises. That means he kept our agenda. Ooh, really? That means everyone has an agenda. So if we're such an important people, then why can't our agenda be constantly heard? He said, when you lose that light, you all who the devil trying to push back into sin and push back in fornication and trying to make you commit fornication and adultery and cheat on your spouse and trying to make you go back to drinking or smoking, or you miss the... See, let me tell you one of the most dangerous things before we pray you can do, and that's be saved year after year and keep missing where God brought you from. And keep, I know people who've been saved double digit years and they still miss clubs. They still miss house parties. They still miss fornication. They still miss anal sex. They still miss homosexual sex. They still miss the world. I talk to all kinds of people. And there's many people who still doing like the Bible said, don't look back. Remember Lot's wife. Don't look back. Lot's wife, don't look back. Just run, baby, but don't look back. When she looked back because she thought she was leaving so much behind and getting ready to miss so much, she turned into a pillar of salt. And the Bible told us to always remember Lot's wife. Don't look back. Don't look back. What, you know what's back there. You know what's back there, a diseased vagina. You know what's back there, a corroded penis. You know what's back there. You know, why are you looking back? Lies and cheating, broke. Why are you looking back? Unemployed. Why are you looking back? Fired, terminated, written up. Why are you looking back? Nasty hands, nasty mouth. Why are you looking back? You know what's back there. Deceit and lying, babies out of wedlock, abortion. Why are you looking back? Why are you going to look at a program and look at something and wish you had that? Wish you had that woman. Wish if God could let you smell in the spirit the scent off of certain people on the TV screen and on the computer, you would say, I don't want that sour stuff. I don't want it. But because you're dark, you can't smell it, you know. All you can do is see it. But why are you looking back? And then why don't you have a message to the world that Christ is the light of the world and God's going to do something for you, but don't look back. He look and says, when you lose me, you're good for nothing. But to be trodden down under men, under the foot of men. Look, not angels, not spirit, just mere men who gonna die and stink like you. But Matthew 5:14 say, but you are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. The enemy can do all. He's tried to do whatever he wanted to do to my life. He's tried it, but he can't hide God's light. He can't hide God's light. And no matter where I am, Florida, the Bahamas, it don't matter, Jamaica, London, the light. He can't hide God's light. Because a city set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick. And it giveth light unto all that are in the house. You come telling me everything in your house dark, and you come telling me that your house full of the devil, and I'm looking at you like, how, when you're in there? When you are the light of the world, turn on the light. Go down so you can be elevated up. Turn on the light. Let your light, the Bible says, so shine before men. At work, on the block, in Jewels, at Aldi's. God knows in Walmart. Let your light, don't open your mouth. Don't take off your mask. Let your light shine. It'll just shine through that mask and shine through that coat. Let your light shine. World need people who need a born again people who could turn on the light. He said, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify the Father which is in heaven. A real light want God glorified. It don't want God glory. So the people out there who want you to pat them on the back and glorify them, they don't have a real light. Because a real light don't speak of itself, but the Father which sent it. That's why I'm careful with all that. This is what 30 look like. This is what 40 look like. This is what 50 look like. This is that foolishness could change with a diagnosis. That foolishness can change with a car accident. It's only things that eternal, and that's Elder Paula always say, what you do for Christ that's going to last. It's only what you do for Christ that's going to last. And in the end, I always tell people, in the end, The only thing that's going to be there in the end were the things that are the things that really matter. Whatever, and you're going to see in the end that so much you thought mattered don't matter. It really didn't matter. It really wasn't that important. How do you know at that time? Because it's not there in the end. It's not there in the end. The only thing that'll be there in the end are the things that were always there and that always mattered. And your light matters. Don't let anyone tell you that walking with God doesn't matter and being saved don't matter. It matters. It matters now, and it matters in eternity. And God knows who want to live this life and then die and go to Him. Who want to do that? And you got a world of people who waiting for a church to turn on the light. To turn on the light. You got unsaved husbands waiting on wives to turn on the light. You got unsaved wives waiting for husbands to turn on the light. You got struggling children waiting for parents to turn on the light. You got struggling grandparents waiting for a grandson to turn on the light. You have people waiting for you to turn on the light, not your mouth. The light. And then whatever you do, as I conclude, whatever you do in Jesus' name, whatever you accomplish in Jesus' name, you make sure you glorify your Father, which is in heaven, and give God the glory. For my glory will I not share with another, neither my praise. And you make sure, no matter how high you fly, or no matter how what you drive, or where you live, or where you work, or who you marry, or how many children you have, or what's in the bank, or how many degrees, or where you travel, and how many planes, you make sure. I'm all the way from the Leclerc Court Projects. You make sure. The one-time STD, a five-year conservative vice lord. You make sure. Been lied on, cheated on, and been a liar and a cheater. You make sure that wherever God elevates you to, that you give God the glory. Because to look in the mirror one time and see that I wasn't fit to live but not ready to die was a humbling experience. And you make sure, I don't care where you office you have, prayer room, I don't care what chandelier lights, I don't care what TV's on the wall, I don't care. You make sure that every so often you stop, you pause, and you just give God the glory. And if you can be so blessed to be surrounded by people who respect that anointing on you and respect the call on your life, you give God the glory. And you let there be light. Let there be light. Let there be light.
When you speak,
let there be light.
Darkness has to bow.
Lift those hands before the Lord.
Confusion has its final hour. When you speak, mountains rise and fall. It tears down every wall around me. When you speak, you breathe upon the dust, you come alive in us. When you speak,
lift
you
those hands before the Lord.
Every fear, we feel your spirit here around us.
Let there be.
Let there be.
As an act of surrender, you lift those hands before the Lord with palms in the air. There's levels of surrender. That's why you wake up for church and you wash your face. You comb your hair, you brush your teeth. You get somewhere where you can reverence God, and you can lift those hands before the Lord.
dust, you come alive in us. When you speak, you silence every fear. We feel your spirit here.
When you speak all around us.
Around us, let there be light. Let there be light. Till it fills up every space. Come and have your way. Let there be light. Let there be light.
If you lost the light, just ask him, come back.
Just one word in
life. If you remember when you were closer to him, just ask him, come back. Repent of all your sins and ask him, come back, Jesus. Come back, Lord. Come closer. Come closer.
Let there be light. Let there be light. With just one word in life and change. Come and have your way. Now you're everything we see.
Come closer, King.
As deep cries out to deep, we will see God.
Just lift those hands and say, come closer.
Hear your glory on display.
But you promised if I draw nigh,
Jesus,
unto you,
Jesus, take your place.
We will see God, that you will come closer.
Now you're everything we seek. As deep as our to deep, we will see God.
You will come closer.
Hear your glory on display.
Jesus, take your place.
We will see God.
Come closer. Let there be light.
Let there be light.
Until it fills up every space.
Until it fills up every space.
Come and have your way.
Come and have your way.
Let there be light.
Let there be light. Let there be light. Just one word.
The light of burn, it'll burn, it'll burn, it'll burn. But the light of God is the light to man.
Until it fills up every space, come and have your way. Let there be light. Let there be light. Just one word and I am changed. Come and have your way.
Lift those hands before the Lord. Just lift those hands before the Lord. Just lift those hands before the Lord. And take a few minutes to just separate yourself. We're not going to have a lengthy prayer. We just want to touch heaven. We just want to touch heaven and change earth. For you are the earth he's changing. And I'm the earth he's changing.
I've got so high to fall so far.
My soul breathing. I found my life. When I laid it down. So come on, take a few minutes and lay it down.
Word falling, spirit soaring. I touched the sky.
When my knees.
When my knees hit the ground.
It's okay to be in places of that feel like pity places or
what treasure waits within
weeping places.
This gift of freedom broken past.
That's the God part.
What the world and so my heart. You treated heaven.
Look in the mirror and say, I'm just feeling life, God.
My heart.
That's a good place to start.
My soul breathing, I found
when you wonder when did the time go? What am I doing with life, and where did all the time go? Every finger reaching out, I surrender.
Come sweep me up in your love again, and my soul will dance on the wings of forever. Find me here at your feet again.
Let your children see you even worship God again.
Reaching out, I surrender.
Let your wife see you weeping before the Lord. Let your husband see you weeping in the presence of the Lord. Let
the wings of forever.
My heart beating, my soul breathing. Let your family see you find life as you lay it down. Spirit soaring. I touch the sky, King, when my knees hit the ground.
When my knees hit the ground, find me here at your feet again.
And here I am at your feet again.
Everything
I am, reaching out, surrender. Come sweep me up in your love again.
Come sweep me up
in my soul with that.
On
the wings
of
forever.
On the wings of forever.
Find me here at your feet again. Everything I am, reaching out, I surrender. Come sweep me up in your love again.
My heart beating, my soul breathing. I feel
young brother, young sister.
When I laid it down.
God see you, and he has you in mind.
When I laid it down.
We pray for the young people in the name of Jesus Christ. For we cannot articulate how hard this quarantine is on them. And how much social development is lacking. For those that wanted this to be my year, whatever that means, that thought this is my year, this year I'm gonna get it together, and this year I'm gonna do better, and this year I'm gonna see God move like he never moved before for me, and hopefully this year I'll meet my husband, hopefully this year I meet my wife, hopefully this year I meet a nice girl, like I meet a nice young man. Hopefully this year, my grades will be better. Hopefully this year, this is my year. And then to find it feeling derailed. And then sometimes locked in with people who cannot understand and comprehend that. Or not doing so well themselves. But you lift those hands, young people. Let God find you here at his feet again. Let me teach you something. Let God find you at his feet again. When he looked for me, I always want to be where he left me last. And let everything that you are reaching out, you surrender. With the cry, come sweep me up in your love again. Then my soul will dance on the wings of forever. For nowhere in scripture does it say you have to be a certain age
or a certain gender to be on fire for God and anointed by God and close to God. Samuel, Samuel. Eli, did you call me? I didn't call you. Samuel, Samuel. You did this time, didn't you call me? I didn't call you. Samuel, Samuel. Oh, I perceive you're not too young, but this is the voice of the Lord that's calling you. And the next time he calls you, say, here I am, thy servant, here again. My heart beating, my soul breathing. I found my life when I laid it down. Sometimes you can't wait for mama to get it together and wait for daddy to get it together. Sometimes you gotta get it together, young people. Upward falling, spirit soaring. I touched the sky when my knees hit the ground. I've had both of my children just come stand in my prayer room before, just come knock on the door, but they knocked on it at a time that I was really reaching, and I just let them come in and look at me and see me. Hands lifted, head down, tears flowing. And just let them feel that intimate anointing, that intimate safe haven. So they brought him in and closed the door and just stand and just say, stand here, just stand there. Feel the love of Jesus. Feel what shall sustain and keep you. Feel what shall lead and guide you. Feel what shall strengthen you. Feel what one day will be what the only thing that can comfort you when words can't do it and people can't do it. Feel what it will override natural circumstances. Feel it and just let them feel the anointing. But you're not too young to get filled with the Holy Ghost. You're not too young to speak with new tongues. You're not too young to lift your hands. You're not too young, but some of you all don't have a curse breaker and you don't have someone that's elevating. So in your home, to the unknown God, him introduce I unto thee. The God that anoints young people and set their souls on fire and fills them with his holy presence and commissions them to be as sheep among wolves. But anointed by God. And where leadership and parenting, guardianship have failed, will let you see too much. The Lord reconcile those differences. And I'm so sorry you can't go to school, and I'm so sorry you can't hang out and play, and I'm so sorry you can't have company, and I'm so sorry. But we must force you to grow up now and allow this time to be a time that you develop a relationship with the Lord and a prayer life and a walk with the Lord. Don't waste it all on nothing. Don't let this time pass you by and you have not gained anything. Bese bere bokurakatarabasi. Besebere bokoraka dara basata. Besebere bokoraka dara basi. Yesekere bokoraka dara basi. Besebere bokoraka dere bokoraka ta. Mesekere bokoraka dara basata. Besebete koshi. For Holy Ghost filled parents are either pointing at their children, interceding for their children, or laying their hands on their children right now. That's what they're doing. And those that can't do it, then we spiritually do it through this avenue. To reaffirm and to confirm and to validate them as children of God and loved by family and cared for deeply. Care for you deeply. Love you without words. Care for you deeply. Love you without words. Love you beyond words and care for you deeply. For we have adults and grown folk that need to know that they have to get somewhere, because sometimes young people need the attention. They need to, the focus can always be about you. My King and my Savior, I ask that you wrap these young people up in a cocoon of love, that instead of night terrors and bad dreams, you allow them to soar in heavenly places and ascend in heavenly places. Instead of bad words and foul language, that they speak the words of God and speak scripture. Instead of filled with darkness, that they be filled with light, some in spite of their surroundings, that they have hope, even though they may have been around hopelessness, to some that even struggled since they've been here because of a parent struggling with, should I have them, should I abort them, should I have them, should I abort them, but now they're here. And that they will feel the security and the validation from up on high. That you were with them yet even in the womb. Now in their present, and you will be there in their future. And that no hurt, harm, or danger will come nigh their dwelling. I ask that you release upon these young people a new level of faith and a new level of hope, with make them not ashamed. In the name of Jesus Christ, from whom all blessings flow, we trust you and we love you with our very lives and the lives of these our children. Let us always be the right role model in front of them as we position ourselves as curse breakers and warriors and men and women of war. In the name of Jesus Christ. When my knees hit the ground, and we will forever be grateful to thee. Forever, forever, forever. Now hold your son and hold your daughter. Give them the necessary touches, the necessary forehead kisses, the necessary cheek kisses, the necessary hand kisses. I got too high to fall.
fall so far, but I found heaven.
It's necessary. We love you. We bless you, my Lord and my King. We honor you with faith. In Jesus' name we pray. We forever commit our love unto thee and our loved ones unto thee. And we'll forever be grateful unto thee. Bless you
at your feet again.
In Jesus' name.
Everything I am.
Bless you, King. Thank God for Jesus. We are dismissed. Thank God for Jesus.
And my soul and debts are the wings of forever. My heart beating, my soul. Everything I am, reaching out and surrender, come sweep me.